St. Mark's Cathedral acknowledges that we gather on the traditional land of the first people of Seattle, the Duwamish people, who are still here, and we honor with gratitude the land itself and the life of all the Coast Salish tribes. Please stand as able for the introit.
Thank you. Alleluia, Christ is risen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, who in the Paschal mystery established the new covenant of reconciliation, grant that all who have been reborn into the fellowship of Christ's body may show forth in their lives what they profess by their faith. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and gave grace, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
A reading from the first letter of John. We declare to you what was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands concerning the word of life. This life was revealed, and we have seen it and testified to it and declare to you the eternal life that was with the Father and was revealed to us. We declare to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him while we're walking in darkness, we lie and do not do what is true. But if we walk in the light as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. My little children, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous, and he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Glory to you, Lord Christ. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them, "Again, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. "Unless I put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." Thomas needs proof of resurrection. As a former healthcare worker, I might say he also needed a pair of gloves before he went about his work. I always get a chuckle when we hear this story each year on this second Sunday of Easter. Thomas is so earnest in his desire to see Jesus, but he needs evidence. He needs physical evidence, embodied evidence. Peter Marty says that Thomas was essentially wanting a first century autopsy as proof that Jesus was alive to take stock of the wounds. That's quite the image, isn't it? For centuries, there was a robust Christian market for relics, including the presumptive bones and body parts of the apostles. These parts, almost never really verifiable, are kept in reliquaries in churches across the globe that serve as shrines for prayerful devotion even to this day. There are at least four churches in Iraq, in Jerusalem, in Rome, and in Ortona, Italy, that all claim to have Thomas's index finger. Now, I know polydactyly is a fairly common genetic mutation, but four index fingers is a bit much, right? Oh, all jesting aside, friends, Thomas's demand for proof seems reasonable to me, given the grief he must have been feeling in those first days. He had just witnessed his dear friend and mentor executed in grotesque fashion literally suffocating to death on the cross because he's unable to lift his weight to get air into his lungs. And Thomas's world has been turned upside down. Nothing made sense. The path forward was unclear, and his heart-stricken grief had him in a quagmire of uncertainty about what to do next. A little observable proof of his friend's report of resurrection seems a small request in the midst of it all. I'm reminded of Elizabeth Kubler-Ross's famous stages of grief. Surely you know of them: denial and anger and bargaining and depression and acceptance. She originally developed them more than 50 years ago for use only by people who had a terminal illness. But they have been extracted and applied to all sorts of grief, and often in spurious ways. As a hospice doctor, I know that bereavement science has long since revealed that we do not move sequentially through grief following these stages in predictable fashion. Some people never land squarely in every stage. So we would do well not to assume that everyone must. Human grief is not linear or uniform in its path. Nevertheless, we all know the emotional experiences that these stages of grief attend to, and I'll belabor it here because I think it's reasonable to conclude that Thomas was grieving deeply, and I think it's reasonable to conclude that we are all bearing a substantial burden of grief in our own time. The litany is long: wars, senseless death of innocents, climate disasters, a tenuous political landscape, social decay. They surely all figure prominently in our collective psyche of grief these days. And then you add to that the vagaries of our individual lives in times of breathtaking loss, or with the cascades of change that necessarily evoke a range of emotions and coping mechanisms, and among them, denial and anger and bargaining and depression and acceptance and many more. The question, it seems to me, is in times such as this, can we hold it all lightly enough to see how these emotions can serve us well in the wake of loss, but also see how they can ensnare us in unhelpful ways if we become trapped by any of them? As it all takes our breath away, we have to remember to breathe. So as I said, it seems to me that Thomas, in his demand for proof and defiance of his friend's report, was dealing at some level with anger in the wake of Jesus' death. He was grieving, but anger can become exacting as a coping mechanism. So we would do well to cut Thomas some slack here. What I find most interesting about this passage from John's Gospel is that when Thomas does meet Jesus, his heart simply melts, and he no longer needs that autopsy of proof. Jesus offers his wounds for Thomas to touch, but nothing in the Gospel suggests that he actually does. He simply believes when Jesus speaks words of peace to him. And in my imagination, he falls to his knees and throws his full weight of being and all those pointing fingers into prayerful devotion in a confession that is as remarkable as any in all the Gospels: "My Lord and my God." Thomas offers us a humble reminder that proof of God's existence is a fool's errand. What we need is the experience of God's presence to breathe again when life has sucker punched us into a breathless grief. And Jesus, as the wounded healer, offers the way, breathes into our midst, but is willing to wait until we are ready, no matter how long that takes. For those early disciples, forlorn and confused and bewildered as they were, Jesus breathes on them and invites them to breathe in the Holy Spirit. His refrain is simply, "Peace be with you." A peace which surpasses all human understanding, a peace that allows us to breathe again. It doesn't take the grief away, but perhaps it can transform it in some way. David Kessler was another bereavement scientist. He co-authored several books with Elizabeth Kubler-Ross in her later years. He has proposed a sixth stage of grief, finding meaning. And isn't that at our core what we're really all striving to find, what we're all really seeking, to find meaning? One of the pitfalls of Kubler-Ross's stage model is that it is often postulated that acceptance is the final turn into letting go of the grief. That is misguided, friends. Acceptance doesn't say, it's okay that my loved one died. It says, my loved one died, but I'm going to be okay. And perhaps finding meaning invites the human capacity to hold that grief alongside the joy and the peace and the love and the hope that serve as sustenance for the journey into that new life, into that new existence, whatever it's going to look like. Bereavement science calls that resilience, the ability to hold the grief and the joy at the same time. As people of faith, we can claim it as a gift from God. Peace be with you. Receive the Holy Spirit. After 40 days of Lent, we now get 50 days of Easter. 7 full weeks to consider what it means to practice joy and peace and love and hope amidst the grief and loss of life. The Paschal mystery is breathed into our midst to find meaning while we practice resilience, never denying the hard stuff that comes our way, but ready to breathe in Christ's peace, spoken in our direction, in your direction, in your direction, here and now, in whatever ways we need to receive it. This wounded healer sees you and knows you and loves you dearly.
Using ancient words of common faith, we join our voices with Christians everywhere as we say the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Show yourself to us as we work and worship, O Jesus, and receive the prayers of your church on behalf of the whole creation as we say, Risen Lord, hear our prayer.
Fill the church with your spirit and teach us to announce the good news of resurrection to all the world. Risen Lord, visit those who exercise authority in our nation and in the world and grant them a vision of your kingdom. Risen Lord, listen to those who cry out to you, O compassionate one, and restore their lives. Risen Lord, gracious one, guide us in our daily work in this community and strengthen us to follow you faithfully and to serve the common good. Risen Lord, look with compassion upon those for whom we pray, especially Linda Lacey, Charlie Calvert, Deborah and Michael Baum, and those we now name. Accept our gratitude for all the blessings shower upon us, especially for the life of Roger Lead, in whose loving memory the nave altar flowers are given, and for those blessings we now name. Comfort those who mourn, and receive into your heavenly glory those who have died, especially Joseph Lieberman, Lou Whitaker, Alan Quigley, Saif Edin Isam Ayad Abutaya, Lauzami Frankum, Damien Sobol, Jacob Flickinger, John Chapman, James Jim Henderson, James Kirby, Richard Tate, and those we now name. Risen Lord.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And the peace of the Lord be always with you.
May be seated. Good morning to you all once again, and a word of greeting to those joining via live stream. We're delighted that you're here, and any who are newcomers to the space, we are glad that you're here and want to know how to best serve you as well. A few brief announcements. Just at the end of this service, before the dismissal, we'll all be invited around the font and join with longtime parishioner Hisako Beasley, who is moving to Tacoma to be near her children and family. And this is her last Sunday with us after decades of being here. And so we will do our custom of blessing her and sending her. And then we'll have cake in her honor in the back corner along with coffee. So do stay on for that. There's also a newcomer's coffee following the service. Get your cake and then head over to Leffler House for that. At 4:30 today, there's a service of choral Evensong in this space. It will also be live streamed. At 5:30, following the Evensong service, an offering of Queering Climate Activism with the Reverend Dr. Lisa Gromlich, climate scientist. The Radix groups are forming for the Easter season right now. These are the small groups that gather once a week for 6 weeks, and we encourage everyone to participate. We just ask, if you do, please register online by this Friday so that we can form the groups. And then lastly, just a few announcements. Parishioners Terry Cochran, who died in late February, her service will be in Thompson Chapel here this coming Saturday the 13th at 10:30. Alan Quigley, a longtime member of this worship service, sitting over there normally, died earlier this week, and his service is Saturday, April 20th at 10:30 in this space. And then also longtime parishioner Richard Tate died Thursday night, and we've not yet set a date for that, but we'll let the parish know when we do. Hold them and your families in your prayers, shall you? Please, thanks.
Wherever you are on your spiritual journey, please know that you are welcome here. You are welcome at God's table. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God.
'Tis truly right to glorify you, O God, our refuge and strength, and to give you thanks. For you alone are God, living and true, dwelling in light inaccessible from before time and forever. Fountain of life and source of all goodness, you made all things and fill them with your blessing. You created them to rejoice in the splendor of your radiance. Countless throngs of angels stand before you to serve you night and day, and beholding the glory of your presence, they offer you unceasing praise. Joining with them and giving voice to every creature under heaven, we acclaim you and glorify your name as we sing.
Glorious in power, your mighty works reveal your wisdom and love. You formed us in your own image, giving the whole world into our care, so that in obedience to you, our Creator, we might dwell as faithful companions with all your creatures. When our disobedience took us far from you, you did not abandon us to the power of death. In your mercy, you came to our help, so that in seeking you, we may find you. Again and again, you called us into covenant with you, and through the prophets, you taught us to hope for salvation. Gracious God, you loved the world so much that in the fullness of time, you sent your only Son to be our Savior, incarnate by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary. Jesus lived as one of us, yet without sin. To the poor, he proclaimed the good news of salvation, to prisoners, freedom, to the sorrowful, joy. To fulfill your purpose, Jesus gave himself up to death, and rising from the grave, destroyed death and made the whole creation new. And that we might live no longer for ourselves, but for the one who died and rose for us, Jesus sent the Holy Spirit, the first gift for those who believe, to complete his work in the world and to bring fulfillment, the sanctification of all. When the hour had come for Jesus to be glorified by you, his heavenly Father, having loved his own who were in the world, Jesus loved them to the end. At supper with them, Jesus took bread, broke it, and gave it to them and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, Jesus took the cup of wine, offered thanks and gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Most Blessed One, we now celebrate this memorial of our redemption, recalling Christ's death and descent among the dead, proclaiming Christ's resurrection and ascension to your right hand, awaiting Christ's coming in glory, and offering to you from the gifts you have given us this bread and this cup. We praise you and we bless you. We praise you, we bless you, we give thanks to you, and we pray to you, the rock of our salvation. We pray that in your goodness and mercy, your Holy Spirit may descend upon us and upon these gifts, sanctifying them and showing them to be holy gifts for your holy people, the bread of life and the cup of salvation, the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Grant that all who share this bread and cup may become one body and one spirit, a living sacrifice in Christ to the praise of your name. Remember, O God, your one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, redeemed by the blood of your Christ. Reveal its unity, guard its faith, and preserve it in peace. And grant that we may find our inheritance with the Blessed Virgin Mary, with matriarchs, patriarchs, prophets, apostles, and martyrs, with Mark and all the saints who have found favor with you in ages past. We praise you in union with them and give you glory through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Redeemer.
Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, all honor and glory are yours, eternal God, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen.
As our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray. gifts of God for the people of God. Emily Meeks will take Holy Communion to Mildred Jesse. One body are we. Go in peace, bearing holy gifts for holy people. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the God who shakes heaven and earth, whose spirit blows through the valleys and the hills, whom death could not contain, and who lives to inspire and bring you into new life, bless you with the power to endure, to hope, and to love. And the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you today and remain with you always.
Before the dismissal, we invite you to come around the baptismal font, our way into the church, and as we send one of our beloved sisters on her way to new waters, we will ask God's blessings upon her. And as I mentioned, there's cake and coffee in the corner. There's also a card to write your greetings and well wishes for Hisako as well. You can get a hand on the shoulder of the person in front of you. It will come all the way to Hisako, who will feel it. Dear people of God, today marks a time of passage for Hisako. As our father Abraham, mother Sarah, and the Holy Family, Joseph and Mary, answered God's pleading, leading, and journeyed to new places, so too Hisako now takes another step in her faith journey. We wish to thank her for her ministry in this place and send her forth with our blessing. Let us pray. We give you thanks, dear God, for granting us the gift of Hisako to be among us as friend and fellow servant of Christ in this place. Send her forth with your blessing that she may continue to grow in holiness and peace through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Amen. Hisako, we commission you a missionary to those southern lands of Tacoma. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, from now on, wherever you go, wherever you are, all the ground between us will be holy ground. And let the people say, Amen. Amen. And we also have a quilt ministry.
Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.